to attend this breakfast symposium in AIOS. Dr. K.K. Mehta is having a lecture in some other room. So we'll start with Rishi Mohan on zeptomania. Rishi Swarup, sorry. Sorry, sir. Dr. Reddy, can you come and sit here?
Can we have this light? All right, so the topic allotted to me is Zepto. That's the exciting new toy that we have in our country since about a year or so. So it's a device like this. It's an innovative disposable device for cataract surgery, which uses something called a precision pulse technology to produce an accurate, reproducible capsulotomy that is quick, safe, and affordable. And you can see that it has a very small footprint. It's a small device to which you directly connect the handpiece, and which is disposable and use it. Very portable, light, and easy to use. It has just three buttons, 1, 2, 3. So how does Zepto work? Basically, this figure is showing the suction cups of a squid's tentacle, and essentially it uses a similar kind of a principle of suction to hold on to the capsule, and it has a ring, metallic ring, made of a material called nitinol, which delivers a small pulse of electrical energy, which creates a focal heating of the capsule and steam, and works like a Fugo blade, except that it works all 360 degrees at once. So that's just a diagram showing the same thing. So the bottom of edge of the capsulotomy nitinol ring touches the capsule at rest. And when you apply suction, the capsule is pulled against the edge. Therefore, you can ensure that there's good contact all around. And when you deliver the energy, there is rapid phase transition of the water molecules, and the capsule is precisely cleaved vertically like that. And because of the heat delivered to the edge also gets coagulated and kind of stands up like this. So the functional edge is actually thicker than the actual thickness of the capsule. So that's what it looks like. You have these little fibrillar attachments, which is nothing but the coagulated protein from the capsule. So that's a 20 micron thickness zeptorexis, and that's what a normal CCC edge would look like. So like I said, there is one console, and you have a handpiece at the tip of which you have a suction cup with a ring like this, and a push rod which makes the ring oblong to introduce it through a small incision of 2.2 millimeters. And once it's inside the eye, you withdraw the push rod so that it springs back to a circular shape. The reason it's able to spring back is because nitinol is a memory alloy. It's also used in cardiac stents. So it tends to come back to the shape which it originally had. It has gone through several prototypes and generations to eventually look like the bottom right picture. And even that has now undergone some more improvements. And so the journey started in 2016, and recently I think it's also received the FDA approval. So that's what the tip looks like. That gray thing is the ring, and the golden wires, metal wires, essentially connected to the console through the handpiece. And the transparent suction cup is made up of silicone, which holds onto the capsule without really damaging it. And because it's transparent, you have a good view of what's going on underneath it. So you can actually see what's going on very well, what's happening to the underlying capsule, etc. So when you push the push rod, it becomes oblong like this and goes in through a 2.2 millimeter incision. And people who have researched this have found that it's quite safe in the antechamber, and there is really very little collateral increase in temperature at other parts of the eye, except where it's supposed to act, which is at the capsule. So this was, I thought, a good video to show the safety of the equipment for the zonules. So the video on the far right shows a rexus being made by a needle for the forceps for capsulotomy. And this is with a zepto, and you can see that the zonules are not really disturbed. In fact, if you see this video, it's probably a little more in the manual capsulotomy. And if you see this set of videos, you see that they're checking the tensile strength of the edge, and you can see that the CCC, a manual CCC, tears are far earlier compared to a zepto CCC. So the zepto is actually stronger, and that's probably because the heat delivered to the capsule makes the proteins coagulate and makes it thicker and probably also stronger. So this, I think, is almost three times stronger, if I'm not mistaken. And they use an equipment like this to kind of test the tensile strength. So you can see that the manual tore at 16 millinewtons and the zepto tore at 60. And they did like a paired cadaveric eye comparison between femto and zepto, and even of course, as expected, zepto definitely outperformed the femto as well. We know that a femto rexus is actually even weaker than a manual rexus. Okay, so just I'll quickly run you through some of the steps. You need to make a 2.8, but you can even get it through a 2.2 incision. It's a snug fit, but it goes through easily. You push the push rod, and then it becomes oblong like this. You can just introduce it into the eye. If it's a 2.2 incision, like I said, it's a snug fit, so you just need to negotiate it a little. If it's 2.8, it just glides in. Then you withdraw the push rod, and you can see it springs back into a circular shape. And you can use an instrument to stabilize the eye. And if the patient is under topical, you can ask him to look at the light, so you center it on one of the Purkinje images. Once you have centered it well, then you ask the nurse to apply suction. There's the first button on the console. And when you apply suction, you see these bubbles moving. They start slowing down, and at some point they stop moving. You also see these kind of radial striae on the capsule. And even though it looks scary that it might be stressing the zonules, it doesn't really do that, because it's uniformly spread all around the stretch. And then you kind of deliver a jet of energy by pressing the second button. And then you release the suction, and you just need to withdraw it out. And you can see most of the time you'll have this kind of a free floating rexus. So it's really, I would say, less than a minute, the whole process. It's very, very fast. And that's one of the big advantages I find over a femto, where you would have to, first of all, shift the patient to another room or another bed. And then everything is so much slower. It adds about 15, 20 minutes to your case. And you get a perfectly round CCC, as you can see in this particular case. And you can manipulate pieces, you can stretch it, you can put a capsular tension ring, it won't tear. It's very, very steady. And as you can see, you get a nice round rexus like that. You will see these white fibrillar things attached to the edge, but they are just coagulated protein. They don't really mean anything. So the a real advantage, I think, comes when you're doing premium lenses, where you want a well-centered rexus and good round rexus. You don't want to lose your rexus, especially if you have like a complicated case like an intumescent cataract, where there is a small possibility you might lose the rexus. In such a case, I think it comes in really handy. So in this particular case, we're using a multifocal toric, and I wanted to be sure that I have a well-centered round rexus. And so in this case, we chose to use a zepto. Of course, if you're a proficient surgeon, you may argue that it's not really necessary, but we all have cases where the rexus runs, and this certainly helps to avoid that to a large extent. I've used it in subluxated cataracts, like in this particular case. I'm sorry, the video is not showing very well on the screen. So almost 4 to 5 clock hours of subluxation in this case. And one would think that putting the zepto and the suction might worsen the subluxation, but it doesn't seem. If your hand is not moving, it's fine. If your hand is not steady, then probably it's not a good idea. So in this case, we just used it like a regular case and just ensured that there was very little movement of the hand. And the good thing is, in a subluxated case, normally the rexus tends to run out. In this case, you can be sure that that won't happen. You'll at least get a very good round rexus. And in this case, we of course put a capsular tension ring, so the bag was stretched and the edge was stretched, and it held really well, not a problem. Of course, in hard cataracts, you need to have a slightly larger rexus, and that really makes your phacoemulsification a lot easier. And in this case, because you're ensured of the size, you can be sure that, and I feel that although the company says it's 5.2, I feel we get a slightly larger rexus, though I have not measured it. And I find, especially in hard cataracts, I tend to advise my patients to go for a Zepto because it makes my life a little easier. My manual rexus is slightly smaller than this. Small pupil is another place where it may be of help, because a femto will not work there. You will need it to go through the iris. So here you can actually introduce the device manually under the edges of the iris. So this was a patient of complicated post-uveitic cataract, and you can see you can actually just kind of nudge the edges of the suction cup under the iris. You have to ensure that everything goes under, otherwise it will still work, but you will end up burning the iris in some place. And then you can, the rest of the steps are as usual. I've also used it in a few pediatric cases, and I think this is another place where it's very useful, because we know that pediatric capsules are very elastic, they tend to run. And just show you this video. So the surgery is as usual, but the advantage is you get a perfectly centered round rexus. Otherwise, pediatric rexus, very rarely that you'll get a perfect round rexus. It'll either be too large or too small or slightly eccentric, or it would run away. So that's really a place where it comes in really handy. And you can see you get a nice round rexus like this you're seeing in this particular case. And then, of course, the rest of the surgery is like you would do in any other pediatric posterior CCC. So posterior CCC is currently not available, but once it is available, essentially, I think they're working on a device, on a handpiece, which will go into the bag and be able to create a smaller rexus. Of course, it'll have to be of a smaller size to be able to fit into the bag. So that's what the prototype looks like. It goes into the bag, and it can probably create a nice little small opening in the posterior capsule as well, like you see in this particular video. So there are some challenges, not a perfect thing. Centration is definitely something you need to learn. So if you're not careful, it can go off center. So if you're doing it in topical, it's a little easier because the patient can fixate. Otherwise, you have to ensure that you center it well on the pupil. It is not amenable for a smaller incision than 2.2 millimeters. So if you're having a machine which does a 1.8, you'll still have to make a 2.2 incision. The consumable is costly for a country like India. You'll end up spending 10,000 rupees extra. Having said that, it's a lot cheaper than the femto. And the lever, I find, used to be a little clumsy. It used to sometimes get stuck, but I think they've improved on it, and now it's fairly smooth, and you can even do it with one hand. Earlier, you had to use two hands. And I'm sure as the newer generations of this come, they'll work on it and make it better. It's not fail-proof. I've had a couple of cases where we did get tags like these, but these were cases where I think the suction didn't, for some reason, work very well. Maybe I didn't apply it well enough. But the good thing is there's already a mark made. So if you use a forceps, it essentially completes it along the same mark. And it's not that this happens often. I've just had this happening in a couple of cases. Like I said, if you're not careful, you can have a decentration, so one has to be careful about centration. But with practice, I think that's not really a problem. So you get a predictable circular CCC, useful in difficult cases, even corneal opacities where you can't see. You can you have a general idea of where you're centering it, you'll get a very good rexus. Recurring cost of handpiece is certainly there. It is quick, short turnaround time, small learning curve. I think this is a very good value. Marketing value is similar to a femto at a much lower price. So if you want to add something to your practice and make it a little more premium, I think this certainly, in my practice, it's made a difference. And yes, there is some scope for improvement, but like every other machine there is, and I'm sure it's going to be a lot more exciting as time goes by. Thank you.
Thank you, Rishi, for the very nice videos and they explain all the small points which are very interesting, especially people who want to start to have a better experience, because you are one of the first persons in India to use it, and of course maybe around the world. So any questions for Swaroop regarding any doubts about that? I mean, people are, it's very important to learn from the
yes, sir.
First learner, first user.
Yeah. I don't think there are any particular guidelines. John is here, he can tell us. But in general, yes, if it's a very shallow anterior chamber, it might be a little difficult to negotiate the instrument. I've done it for a case which in a post-angle closure glaucoma cataract, and you have to be a little careful. So you should, in these cases, I think it's a good idea to use a cohesive viscoelastic, which helps to kind of deepen the chamber a little bit, and then you go ahead and do your zepto.
This hyper mature with the liquid cortex, how
yes,
it
sir.
Works, have it done and how it works?
Yes, I've used it and it does work very well.
Second thing is, in presence of vitreous, do you do the vitrectomy before you do it or you do it without it? Suppose a vitreous
I have
there,
never so. Had to use it in the presence of vitreous, but that would certainly be a challenging thing because it may not grip the capsule very well if
that
it's
is.
Coming into that zone.
Plus it is inducing some
so
suction.
So you would have to first do a vitrectomy, I'm guessing, and then do this.
Do you need to put any of these trifine blue before
you?
You
don't need to, but it's not a bad idea to do it in the beginning, especially if you want to make a nice surgical video and show it. It shows very well, but
does
it's
it
not mandatory at all.
Does it work differently in different type of viscoelastic?
I've used it with HPMC, with chondroitin sulfate, and with sodium hyaluronate, and it seems to work with all of them.
With the same force.
Yeah, I have not really found a difference.
Do
and maybe John can tell us more.
Yes, the device is designed to use it on primarily almost all viscoelastics, except to two heavily viscous ones like Helon GV or Helon 5. Other than those two, we have found all types of viscoelastics being able to be used without a problem.
See, the problem which probably I think is that because of high viscosities, the suction may not come to the level which we desire to have. Does
well
it happen that way?
Yeah, it's two things that can happen there. Is that because of the viscosity, is that that suction cup will start to move around trying to get to a center place, and you can lose your centration.
Yes.
So I just really advise don't try to use those two. But in terms of the anterior chamber depth, we've used it down to 2.0 up to 4.2.
And what is the temperature achieved at the site of capsular axis, which
I
is sufficient for the coagulation of the
So at the site of the capsule, it
yeah.
produces enough temperature to produce steam, but there is no collateral increase in temperature.
That's okay, but what is the temperature achieved at the site? Can you
I think
you
it's beyond 100 degrees. What is it?
No, at the we were very particular about this because, as you know, femto creates an enormous amount of heat in the eye, which causes a prostaglandin release. So what we did is, at the time that we were doing surgery in rabbits, we inserted a thermocouple into the eye right next to the silicone suction cup where the ring is. And the temperature increase was only 1 to 2 degrees over 2 seconds. That's it. And it's because of the fact that when we deliver energy in 4 milliseconds, as in any kind of heat propagation, you have to have time to be able for it to propagate. So what we are doing is that we are focusing on the molecules directly under the ring and heating those water molecules up, and they burst, and it's basically a steam cut, but done with very, very little transfer of heat.
And the second thing is, does it increase the chances of something like phimosis after doing the...
I have not noticed that. I have now almost been using it since a year now, exactly a year in fact. And I have not had in any of my patients phimosis.
Do you recommend anterior capsule polishing after this or no? With this method? Is it, important?
To be honest, I'm
no?
not really sure. I'm not doing it because I don't even do it for a regular cataract, because that is known to cause more capsular fibrosis.
And the last thing is, in case of pseudo exfoliation, how does it work?
I think there again it's very useful because pseudo exfoliation, these zonules are a little weak, so you can be ensured that you get a adequately sized rexus. And because in my hands I feel that it's a little larger than the rexus that I make, and it's always better pseudo exfoliation to go a slightly bigger rexus than smaller.
And the weak zonules, does it have any something like donesis is there but not subluxated? Does it work well? Or
yeah, I've used it in a couple of subluxated cases.
Not subluxated. The zonules are weak.
Yeah.
There is a donosis. It's not moved anywhere. No vitreous in the AC.
Yeah, if it's working for subluxated, it'll work for those also.
Okay.
It works fine.
If you see posterior anticapsule fibrosis or sometimes calcified, you know, those cases, have you tried? Or
I'm sorry, I didn't get you.
Anticapsule fibrosis.
Yes, sir.
So. And sometimes you
yes,
see calcified.
Okay. So like a calcified. No, I haven't had an opportunity to try, but my guess is it wouldn't work in a calcified capsule.
Okay. Anything from your side?
Yes, we've done a number of them. The device has really been developed to cut up to about 80 to 90 microns of capsule tissue. But the unique thing about it, unlike on a femto that will go through the capsule and into the lens material, this does not. It stays in only in the relationship to the capsule. So when we have seen some very thick capsules and with a lot of material that has accumulated there, we've been able to cut them very successfully so far.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you.
We invite the next speaker, Dr. Navneet, on his talk on DLI, dysfunctional lens index.
DLI. Good morning, respected chairperson, colleagues. All the my family of care group. First of all, I thankful to AIOC team for today's walkathon with the Saurav Ganguly, and big thanks to the care group for giving this opportunity me to talk on a dysfunctional lens index for clinicians. I will introduce the topic that the Tracy technology, which is I am using since 2.5 years or almost 3 years, and first time they have put this machine in the way that whether it is useful for refractive surgery, whether to do or not, or cataract, but I have exclusively used for my cataract practice this machine from day one because I am not doing any refractive practice still. And when I notice, because I am practicing in a Solapur like area where we are doing the surgeries on the basis of the visual acuity. If it is less than this, really patient is having problem. So early cataracts, early lens changes, we have never tried. But this Tracy technology has changed completely the scenario of my practice of evaluating the cataract. What is the most important today? It's just not the vision. It's a quality of vision we have to give. We have to listen to the patient, what exactly is the patient's complaint. DLI is a dysfunctional lens index. This is a new software they have added in this Tracy machine for this lens functioning. Very important cases, I just highlight 4 or 5 cases, is the posterior subcapsular cataract. That may be the immediate indication. Patient is a 40-year male, 6-12 vision, and patient is having difficulties. On a clinical examination, pointer is there. On clinical examination, you can see that typical rainbow appearance, and in this case, although patient is having 6-12 vision. 6-12 vision, but you can see the early cataract in the center. And when we see the picture on this iTrace machine, Previously, we used to evaluate this E, how it looked. This is the corneal E, this is the lenticular E. It is a hazy view. We can diagnose that, yes, patient is having difficulty, definitely. But when you see here the functioning of the lens, DLI is a 1.36. So it is a quite less, and this is really indication to do the cataract. A very important another condition is the steroid-induced cataract. In a steroid-induced cataract, again it is a posterior subcapsular, very early cataract, and you can see here the cat. You can see here the cataract, and patient is having 6-9, 6-12 partial vision, but when you look at the picture, again the same way, you can see the DLI. So you can explain to the patient very comfortably, patient is having complaint, sometime doctor neglected, sometime patient neglected. But here is the tool that will give you the clear idea that yes, DLI is less, we can do the surgery in this case. This is another very important condition is the cataract with the chronic uveitis. Most of the time, what we feel is that the patient may be having the inflammation, vitreous may be inflamed, how is the retina, what is the condition. So we are not ready to do the cataract immediately in such cases. Of course, with all protocols, we have to remove the cataract. But what is the most important thing is patient is having 624, 636. You cannot see much lens changes. But because of this inflammation, and then I noticed some changes after dilatation. What I am doing in my practice, first I do the undilated examination on a tracy. I get real some changes of DLI and lens changes. And you can see here the clear cut picture. Or E is, see the E of this lens and see the 1.51 is the DLI. So that is very interesting part, so that you can at least think of that the functioning of the lens is not good and we have to do something for this lens. Again, the same case, you can see the best corrected visual acuity is 624 and all that. You can see some droplet-like, very early lens changes. And you can see again the picture of this 1.75. So in this way, the indications of cataract, real indication of cataract has increased in the practice. And it is a very important tool that confidently we are getting idea. Yes, patient is having the difficulty for vision. Another very important condition, I have already mentioned that we are practicing in Solapur, cortical cataract. Patient may or may not having complaint. Some patients are having definitely complaint. We neglect it. There is no central lens changes and all that. And then these cases, this is the study going on last year in New Orleans. I have put a huge data of this study in front of the, there was a session of a tracy technology among the 100 doctors. We have given this session. And cortical cataract, you can see that we found that lens is not that much damaged, but see, DLI is a 3.43. So that may be the early indication to remove this cataract to give the best corrected visual acuity to the patient and the quality of the vision. PCO, this is another condition. If you are doing cases, cataract, your case has come up, you have evaluated previously, you can do. But sometime patient has been come of doctors, other doctors, then you have to see for, and there is no, just clinically I will see the capsule and whether to cut it or not. So this is a very another important indication which I noticed, and in some cases after the capsulotomy, immediately after 10 minutes I have taken the patient on a DLI and it has improved. So that proves that yes, this capsule is making the nuisance. That is the picture in a capsule thickening, a 4.74 we have done. One patient has come with a myopia with a nystagmus, 22-year-old female. For she was having the high myopia, best corrected visual acuity was 660, and she has come for refractive surgery for that purpose. And then we have seen the lens, and this is what we have seen in that particular case with 1.01. In the myopic case, such a type of lens picture is there, such a type of, you can get the idea of the cornea lens at a time with this fantastic tool, and you can give the best treatment. Remove the lens, that will be the better. Traumatic cataract, if you will see the undilated pupil, this is the pupil, we don't know anything, I have already mentioned, take the patient on Tracy, it will give idea, dilated, and then notice the cataract, and this is the picture on a tool. So most important point is that our early indications of the cataract removal has definitely clear idea about because of this dysfunctional lens index is one of the fantastic software. And for as a cataract practitioner also, when you will try to put these cases, normal cases after the age of 45, 50 on this tool, you will get the different changes. And now, recently I have started a study of diabetic cases, all diabetic cases, whether there is having cataract or no cataract, nothing. I started putting on this tool to see the lens physiology functioning on this, and that is giving a very, very interesting points to the me. So I am very much thankful to the care group to have such a wonderful tool with them, Tracy technology. And finally, this is changed my all the concept, because for the quality of vision, we have to think such type of tool. Decision making is a very important in a cataract practice. Just having a lens opacity then to do, but without lens opacity, if you can have such a type of tool, you can do the better justification to the patient. And that's the last line, evaluating the lens function prior to the lens opacity, that is the main aim. And this has changed my clinical practice to the different way. And this is all what I wanted to say for this, Tracy. Thank you. Thank you very much for your patience hearing.
Audience, sir, I have a few questions for you. The front layer, what you are saying is the cornea, the lens.
Yeah.
Now, the corneal evaluation, does it include the posterior surface in this machine or no?
Means you are
the posterior corneal surface.
Posterior corneal surface. Exactly, I don't know idea. Overall, corneal.
It does not.
Yeah.
Plasma-based one, it's not a shine flag, so the only anterior surface, so the posterior surface is not included, so the astigmatism, there is a question as you are telling, the posterior corneal astigmatism.
Correct. So when you are evaluating the lenticular portion, the lens, that includes everything minus the afferent surface. Yeah.
Exactly.
So you have to be little careful if there is a keratoconus,
yeah,
and the lens function is normal, you will get the same picture, something similar of the improper DIL. So if you have a pentacam or any of the devices along with this, that it will be more accurate than the only this eye trace machine.
Right.
The second thing is, you have any other mode other than e-chart where you can evaluate the surface?
Not with me really.
Other than E. We have you have shown the e-chart.
Yeah.
Do you have an option to select like point spread functions, or you have an MTF? Is there anybody who can answer this? You can. Please come. Can you have an option of selecting the... Please take the mic.
Yes, yeah. Sir, so we have an option for that one. We have a point spread function, modular transfer function option also. So we have a different type of stars, not even E. We have a letters also, like C.
You have a letters
yes,
function. What is the cutoff... DIL, where below that you say is normal and above that you are likely to have a...
Yeah, there is no perfect cutoff, but that depends upon the complaint of the patient, and sometimes when I don't fail...
No, this is without the complaint.
Yeah, no, without complaint, then I have to follow the patient for another 2-3 months and then I will see the things.
Did you find any difference between dilated and undilated normal people with this machine?
Yeah, but if the readings are not coming, undilated is a very important... that is the giving the correct idea of the central axis and all that.
No, the mesopic and the scotopic pupils.
That is also very interesting.
Did you find any difference in the various groups of people, like younger age, about 19 years old, then go to 40 and then 60 years, a different age group? Did you find any quality? Because that is one thing where the accommodation gets lost and it does not compensate the spherical aberration, which is there up to the age of 40, and then it starts deteriorating. So many times you see old people complaining of loss of vision or decreasing the vision quality also without any reasonable cause, like cataract or any corneal, where they cannot compensate the peripheral spherical aberration. Do you have any data where you can demonstrate that this is what the deterioration that has occurred, even with the normal human being?
No, that's a
that
very
is
good
one
question.
Thing which
yeah,
can
that
be
we
used
have to
in
do.
This.
Exactly.
The accommodation factor, yes, sir. It affects the DLI changes of the lens function also.
Without any lenticular visible lenticular
yes,
changes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
With you have that.
Factor, yes, sir. But you have. The paper is not available, but
that's okay.
Yeah.
But there is a concept which is can be possible.
Yes, sir.
That's
possible.
A good
because
point
we use
to
a similar
do the
machine.
Study. Yes.
Where we have selected the lenses according to the spherical aberration based on these machines. And it has really worked that 70% of the patients can go up to 6-4 vision. I think Dr. K.K. Mehta knows about it. 70% of the patients can go up to 6-4 vision. And ultimately, you will have to have a high definition quality vision for all our patients, even in selecting the lenses which is there. This is one thing which is going to be a future for cataract surgery. Where, in fact, we have started promising 4K vision or high-definition vision based on selection of various lenses. To most of the patients, we are quite accurately achieving the whatever predictability we are forecasting before the surgery. Now,
thank
I
you.
Invite Dr.
Thank
Reddy.
You.
Thank you, sir. I invite Dr. Reddy to give his talk on Acreol, the versatile IOL, most complete hydrophobic monofocal IOL. I welcome Dr. K.K. Mehta, who was busy in the other lecture. So he'll be taking the last lecture of this session.
Good morning. Yeah, we are running short of time. 8:55, we have to give the hall. We got another 20 minutes. So this is a new platform is launched by Care Group. This is Acreol versatile. What is the so specialty about this lens is this as usual their proprietary material, the hydrophobic material without the glistenings, that is their flagship material. They are using the same material and which doesn't produce a vacuole formation. The glistening effect is very very minimal, almost negligible. We cannot find in this. And the other things like cat's eye syndrome, and the blue blocker, this is a very novel dye. They put a very slight, not very strong yellow color. It just mimics like a natural lens. And the flexibility is fantastic with this material because it's not a lathe cut material. It's a molded design. So because the molded design, they can increase the flexibility according to their convenience and the capacity of the technology. Basically, whereas in lathe cut, where the other lenses are made, the material has to be hard to cut it in the lathe. That is a major problem. So they are able to solve this problem by a molding design. When it comes to the optics, there are two things, as I told you. One is the lathe cut, one is the molded. The lathe cut optics will have a lot of grooves at the end of, and it will be polished by tumble polishing. The tumble polishing just makes it smooth. It doesn't make all foci come to the single point. Whereas in molar design, you don't need any polishing to make a anti-surface very smooth. So it's already there, smooth surface, it takes the surface of the mold. So that gives a fantastic optical surface consistently in each and every lens, whereas molded is not the same thing. So this is the main difference between the quality of the vision, though the power is the same with both the lenses. And coming back to the aspheric optics, they have selected after careful study, after many designs, they selected a neutral aspheric optics in this. It is neither positive nor negative. So their concept is that the basic idea is even if it's left behind, it's left behind with a very small, less than 0.07, something like a negative asphericity, which is really doesn't affect the quality of vision and gives little depth of focus, which is very, very important in the cases. And of course, there was a concept that decentration does neutral optics are better for, but this lens doesn't decenter at all. It's a perfectly center center the capsule back, because this is one of the few lenses where I will show you the why it doesn't decenter. When it comes to the, as I told you, surface quality is fantastic with this lens because of the molding design and accuracy of the power throughout the lens because of the, again, because of the molded design of the manufacturing process. The power accuracy is, if you look at the power map, it's a very, very uniform model. It's not the average power of many powers. It's like in lathe cut lenses, it is the power is throughout the lens, it is the same. And another important thing is the square edge. What happens in square edge in a lathe cut lens is when they polish the lens in tumble polish, the edge goes off. It is a square rounded edge. It's not a square sharp edge. Whereas here in molded lenses, there is no need for polishing. So you get a square sharp edge. And this is the design, what I'm talking about. This is very innovative. And this is, it's a plate haptic. Yeah. It's a plate haptic lens in the hydrophobic. There are no other companies making, as far as I know, a plate haptic in hydrophobic. All hydrophilics will be plate haptic. All hydrophobics will be C-loop lenses, because you need a really soft, flexible material to make a plate haptic lens in hydrophobic material. That needs a lot of research and a lot of technology, which they are able to make it. And the lens insertion, there is a direction. Though the rounds are all onto the side, this is always to the left. They always do in their in care group, all the lenses, the hole in IPCLR, everything is onto the left. They like on the left side. I don't know why some people like on the right side, but this company, they put the marking haptic on the left side. So this is the overall lens. This is you got a very flexible haptic pads here, which will mold to the size of the lens, so irrespective of the lens size. So though it is a plate haptic lens, the pads will adjust to the capsular back and lens fits very snugly in the back. This lens will be very, very nice for me, especially for toric. It doesn't move at all. So if you have a toric lens in this, it will be one of the most perfect designs. And this is the implantation technique. Put BSS and leave it for a minute. They say 30-40 seconds, but usually I leave it for one and a half minute. And usually my staff do it when I start doing cortical wash. They open it up and put the BSS and leave it for some time. And inject BSS from the front also. Even you can do with BSS, or if you want, you can put viscoelastic from the front end after you close your the catheter. It's a preloaded, comes in preloaded. Another very nice feature of this is a preloaded lens. Just put a little bit of angulation. You don't need to shoot it to the optic nerve when you are shooting it, the lens. You put little angulation of the thing, just though you are looking at the pars plana. Then inside the lens, the haptics, the leading automatically goes into the back. Putting the trailing haptic is a little bit tricky because we got used to the C-loop lenses. We just dial them. We cannot dial this lens that easily, so we have to just tuck it. That is the slightly different. So most of the people, I do understand, they use only C-loop lenses. They might have not never use the this design, so the plate design. So for them, it takes a little bit practice, and you can confidently push it. It looks like the entire lens is moving, and you are worried zonules will become, because this lens is so flexible, there is nothing to worry about. The centration, as I told you, is fantastic with this lens, and it will never decenter whatever capsular back fibrosis comes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Reddy. Any questions for him? I'll invite Dr. K.K. Mehta to give his talk on ERG for every clinic with diopsis.
Reddy sir, it is easy to move the lens to the particular dial. Suppose if it will come in toric, it's a very stable four petal.
Yeah, so it's not
easy to move also to that particular axis.
We can move it, we can rotate it. It's not as simple as C-loop.
Exactly.
It takes a little bit, that's what gives the more stability for
you. You have the new connector?
BSS.
Just give my bag.
what is the significance of BSSM?
See, this is the cartridge.
Yeah,
the
cartridge
is coated with a hydrophilic material. So it's dry in a dry stage. Once
so
you put BSS
it.
And leave it for 20 seconds, 30 seconds, it dissolves and it absorbs the water and it becomes a lubricant for the cartridge. It's the cartridge technology that needs a BSS for.
Yeah.
It's not a fat coated one. That's a different.
Okay, thank you. What should be the optimum size of the CCC? Because in plate haptics, sometimes it's difficult to tucking.
So this is exactly in this is you need around 5.5. You need 5. You cannot do 4.5. That's a little different, these lenses. You need a 5.5 mm lenses.
So if we have made by chance 4.5, we have to enlarge it.
Yes, you have to enlarge. Before putting the lens, you have to enlarge. Otherwise, you will have some trouble.
I think Dr. Kiki Mehta is ready. We have to vacate the hall
in, eight minutes.
8 minutes.
I think all of you are lucky today because you have this opportunity of listening to JK and after JK an opportunity of listening to me for the very simple reason that I'm going to introduce you a little toy, what I call as a diaphysis ECG, ERG machine, which really makes a world of difference. I had an ERG machine which I was using, which was a Roland. I acquired this little toy about, I think about 6 months ago, I think in December last year. And since then we've been using it and we have found it extraordinary. Let me introduce you to it. To those of you who are not ERG experts, I'm going to start you off with a little basic and then bring you up to form. Now, the applications for ERG are, as you are aware, literally through the book. You can evaluate diffuse changes, chronic ischemic, hereditary disorders, damage and trauma, and toxicity. But that is not the reason why I acquired the machine. The reason why we are using the VEP PRG in our office is to evaluate glaucoma suspects with a high-risk optic nerve, whether we should treat or not, give reasons for unexplained field defects and differentiate between other diseases and glaucoma and, of course, multiple sclerosis and chloroquine utilization. Now, one of the problems with the olden day machines was it took close to anywhere between 20 to 40 minutes to do a case. At the end of it, you were left with a page full of squiggles in your hand, almost impossible to interpret. And they required a highly trained operators because the moment your operator got a little lazy, he gave you a set of squiggles, which is impossible. The result was that ERG is now limited to large research institutions of academic interest, and you would never utilize it. But why is the diaphysis so great, and what makes the difference? The difference essentially is that with this, you have a simple protocol guide system. It's operator friendly. Anybody can do it essentially. And you do the test in just 10 minutes flat. At present in America, it is installed on Europe also. It's installed in over 1,200 offices. I think in India, probably there are one or two units which have come in. But that is it. Now, there are two important. I'm not going to talk to you about all the variables because I have only 8 minutes. So I'm going to stress only on the important, interesting parts, which will give you a reason why you should go to the care group and buy the machine. And the first is a talk about PRG and what it really means. When we talk of PRG, what is PRG? Pattern ERG. Essentially, you give a checkerboard pattern. It elicits a ganglion cell response and is an accurate, objective indicator of ganglion and macular function. Now, the unit, what it does essentially is gives you an option of utilizing either concentric or contrast sensitivity or concentric stimulus fields. Contrast is very useful for evaluating things like chronic open angle glaucoma and diabetic retinopathy, while on the other hand, the second alternate, which is the concentric, is useful for also for ARNB macula and toxic maculopathies. PRG is a signal which is registered at the lower lid in response to a visual stimulus. What we call as a pattern ERG is attributed to the retinal ganglion cells. And this is the measure of the electrophysiological activity of the retina and helps the clinician differentiate between retinal and optic nerve disorders. Now, the other option is the VEP.
The VP utilizes a visual evoked potential, essentially enables you to evaluate from the entire system, right from the eye up to the visual cortex, and typically has three waves. I'm going to talk to you a little of this basic stuff so that when I show you pictures of glaucoma, you can assess it yourself and know how simple it is. The most important, of course, is the standard P100, which is the peak wave on top, and the waves, the two other little waves of P75 and 150. Now, the one big advantage of this system is that it gives you the data as it comes. Now, unlike presenting you the whole pile of squiggles, it gives you the data published. If you see on top, first is the waveforms. You see the standard undulating waveforms is a typical of us, what we call as a steady state PRG response. Now, it gives you the alternate, and what it does is it evaluates for you in advance and tells you as to whether it's in the normal parameter zone or not by giving you colors. Simple to identify. Green means it's in normal parameter zone. Red means it is not. Now, when you see waveforms, unlike the previous one, you see the waveform here and now you see the waveform here. Notice the gross distortions. These are not regular, and this is because of multiple changes which are occurring from the response, which the machine is assessing and telling you that this is a problem which is occurring. What it tells you is the magnitude and the magnitude D or D ratio, and it tells you the difference between the two and how to assess it and how to evaluate it. The magnitude D and the magnitude ratio is what tells you as to how powerful the signal is and how good the optic nerve is. The magnitude D ratio should roughly be half the total of the magnitude ratio. And if it is that or within that reasonable limits, you know it is fine. If it is not, it goes out and gives you a red one. Let's talk a little about VEP. As you know, VEP is the difference between the front and the back near the optic cortex. And any changes in between, especially optic neuritis, retrobulbar optic neuritis, these changes can come out very simply with this. You no longer have to have problems. You have one little electrode in the forehead, one at the side, and one at the ideon, which is the back of the head. And we just entirely just simply measure the third thing. And it gives you waves, and it gives you multiple waves, which it fuses and evaluates and tells you how good is the amplitude, which is from the base of the A up to the B wave, which is the length, and it also gives you the latency. Latency means the length of time it takes for the signal to travel. When the nerve is affected, common sense indicates to you and me, the latency will be more. So if you can evaluate latency and the magnitude or the height of the wave, you can then do your judgments accordingly. And it tells you by giving you a color coding. Green indicates is good, yellow indicates it is ha-ha, and red indicates is bad. Green works out in 95% of the cases. In the residual 6 or 4% of the cases, or it is yellow or it is red. And it is either crimson or red. It also gives you a signal index and tells you how good your signal is. And finally, by checking the signal quality, you know it is working or not. And it will give you a waveform like this. As I said, a classical ABC form, which is there with a little peak on top of your P100. And you can evaluate the two and gives you a green signal indicating it is good, or a signal which is bad, indicating the quantum which is affected, and will tell you the changes between the high contrast and the low contrast latencies. Why is high contrast and low contrast important? Because as you are aware about what we call as parvocellular and magnocellular, let me go on for a few seconds later and get you aware. But now let us apply a little knowledge to how it will interpret the simplest and most common disorder, which is glaucoma. Glaucoma has been reported to be affected, will affect the VEP by affecting both reduction in amplitude as well as latency. So we now know that by affecting these two, we can detect it. At the same time, PRG, amplitude, tells you the function of the ganglion cells right in the beginning. So it tells you how much loss has occurred there. And it is something which anticipates an equivalent loss. Now, for example, previously we had only fields, and then came OCT, which could judge it 5 years in advance. And now has come the PERG and the VEP combination, which can judge it by further 5 to 7 years earlier. So literally a person who is a suspect glaucoma by evaluating, by utilizing the combination of PRG and VEP, you can know as to whether he has got glaucoma, whether changes are likely to occur or not. And the PRG is a strong indicator of response, while the VEP gives you the excitability of the thing. Now, where to use, there are various stages. I won't go into it in detail. But just to bring you up to par, that the magnocellular pathways, which you see over here in the lateral geniculate body, the magnocellular pathway affects the high contrast gain, and it affects partial resolution, the ability to walk, the ability to judge a moving object, while on the other hand, the parvocellular checks color, low contrast, and high spatial resolution. So the VP gives you both for both the high resolution and the low resolution, so you can utilize it to see exactly where it comes. Now let us quickly look at a few case studies and we can know how it is. This was a glaucoma evaluation of a patient. This is taken from one of the training sessions which is set up by Diapsis Group itself. And as you notice, if you look at the optic nerve pictures, it looks pretty okay, nothing much to rave about. And if you look at the fields, you notice that there are arcuate changes on both eyes. And looking at it, you will automatically turn on and feel it's a glaucoma suspect. And you should be a problem. And you do his HRT. You can ONH, RNFL changes. And looking at it tells you again that the optic nerve is affected, no question about it. And the changes are there. You notice the size of the clarity between the two levels of the base plates. And but now when you assess it, what does it tell you? If you look at the PERG, the PERG, the pattern ERG is fairly normal. There's really nothing much to rave about. And on the other hand, the VP again is within fairly normal levels. So we know that despite the fact that he has shown changes in the optic nerve and the patient now is on treatment for a prolonged period of time, the question is, does he need additional treatment? Essentially, when you look at these pictures, it tells you he really needs only a follow-up. Additional treatment is not required. Otherwise, on that patient, you would have put him down and parked him and said, hey, friend, you are due for trabeculectomy. Let us take another quick case. In a similar manner, a glaucoma evaluation, whether we should treat or not. If you look at the pictures, are not too bad. You look at the field losses, you notice a little sector areas involved, but otherwise the fields are really not involved much. But on the other hand, when you now look at the PERG changes here, notice the waves are no longer are stable. The magnitude and the frequency and the latency is automatically there. And you look at the VEP again showing early changes, indicating that in this patient, though the IOP remains in the low teens, follow up without medication, but you need to repeat PERG regularly because this sort of a patient is going to go in for loss. Only a question of time. So he needs to be followed up regularly. In case he doesn't want to be followed up regularly, he has to be put on at least a single drop as a safety measure. So in useful in clinical measurement, it gives complementary tests and tells you how to go about them. Let's quickly look at the next case, which is even worse, where the fields are severely affected. And we did the ENT test, and the test again indicates essentially the same changes. You look at the pictures on the quality of pictures is not very good, but if you now notice the changes which are there on the ONH RNFL patterns, the optic nerve patterns, you notice that there are significant changes which are occurring, and the VEP now shows a gross abnormality, indicating you can now know exactly that these changes are occurring. The latency is significantly affected over here, and indicating that there have been significant changes occurring in this problem. On the other hand, there are changes which work out. So you know that you can handle these cases in this manner. Let's look at these pictures here. Now notice at the VEP, gross breakdown of changes are occurring with multifocular late changes in the magnitude and the, as well as the latency severely affected. This sort of a patient you know is going to go, if he's not properly treated and his pressures are maintained really low, is going to go into difficulty. So your ability to manage these cases becomes significantly better. This case is being followed up repeatedly and you notice the changes which are occurring progressively. And the same thing occurs in the right and the left eye in the ONH RNFL changes. And this is again reflected in the PERG as well as in the VEP. So this is a very sensitive indicator of how we can go about. And in cases where it really gets damaged, it literally goes into a breakdown in the system where the transmissions are altered and the PERG is completely affected, giving you almost flatline curves. So glaucoma detection thus becomes very simple with this procedure. It gives you the ability to judge your patients, gives you the ability to evaluate them more accurately, lets the patient look at his own charts and knows that he needs to come more frequently to you and it needs to be evaluated more regularly. And the evaluation needs to be done utilizing the ERG system and not just by utilizing field systems. So in summary, it can be of tremendous help in your daily diagnosis since it takes hardly 8 minutes to do and gives you reproducible results, really reproducible. You can do it 5 times in a row and you get almost identical reason. And it does all your calculations. It does this tool which works in literally minutes. I've only tried to talk to you about glaucoma, but it works in a host of alternate methods and can be of great help in ophthalmic problems. And like the OCT, most important of all, it'll probably pay for itself in 9 months. After that, it is well wet for the Lord. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, sir. And because of lack of time, we are just closing the session. Thank you for all audience for the participation.